From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Well, good afternoon again, ladies and gentlemen. I'll introduce myself. I'm Bob Patrick with the Veterans History Project. I've got a question to ask. Are there any World War II veterans in the House? I don't see any hands going up. Sons and daughters of World War II veterans. Okay. You represent your parents. We want your story. Learn how you can tell your parents' story to the Veterans History Project at the table in the back, and they'll tell you how to do that. Well, we're very excited again to have Rick Atkinson return to the National Book Festival. Rick is an author who has been awarded Pulitzer Prizes in journalism and history. He began his career in journalism in Kansas, later working for 18 years at the Washington Post. His reporting and writing earned him awards on subjects that included local news, crime, and Vietnam veterans. He also wrote on defense issues, presidential politics, and international affairs. He was posted in Europe and in Africa. During his time as a journalist, he authored books about America's military involvement and those who served in America's armed forces. His first book was The Long Gray Line, The American Journey of West Point's Class of 1966. The class of 66 at West Point had more casualties than any other class of any other service academy. He also wrote in 1993 a book, Crusade, The Untold Story of the Persian Gulf War, a book on Desert Storm. In 1999, Rick left the Washington Post to dedicate himself to writing about the subject for which he had a great passion, World War II. In 2002, the first volume of the Liberation Trilogy was released, An Army at Dawn, The War in North Africa. It was followed by The Day of Battle, The War in Sicily and Italy, and the series concluded with The Guns of Last Light, The War in Western Europe. The Liberation Trilogy has been termed a monumental achievement. Any of us who have read it have been treated to seeing World War II not just in the historical context, but in the human context of the hearts and minds and personal quirks of those who fought in World War II, from five-star generals to PFCs. Rick Atkinson is the son of a World War II veteran and also proudly carries the title of Army Brat. Both of these personal experiences have informed his writing. Please join me in welcoming a great friend of the Library of Congress, Mr. Rick Atkinson.
Thank you for that. Thanks so much for joining me this afternoon. I apologize to those of you who are here expecting to see Brokaw. You missed him by an hour. I've lived in Washington for almost 40 years, and this, the National Book Festival, is my favorite event in our town. It assembles the components that make reading magic. Authors, editors, publishers, readers, and of course, books. A book festival, like a library or a museum, has the ability to transport us to distant eras and faraway places. And we're going to take an opportunity to use this time machine to do just that, going back seven decades. On this past Wednesday, as many of you know, September 2nd, the world commemorated the 70th anniversary of the formal end of the Second World War. So this is a good time to make a few assessments about the war before we open it up to your questions and your comments. The novelist John Updike once called the Second World War the 20th century's central myth, a vast imagining of a primal time when good and evil contended for the planet, a tale of Troy, whose angles are infinite, and whose central figures never fail to amaze us with their size, their theatricality, their sweep. I spent 15 years writing 750,000 words in three volumes about just the American role in the liberation of Europe. The liberation of Europe starts, as that saga starts for me in that first volume, in North Africa, not in Europe. And then the second stage of that liberation moves 100 miles across the Mediterranean to Sicily, and then to the mainland of Italy. And then the third and final act begins, as you know, in Normandy, and proceeds across Western Europe. I'm more convinced than ever that the Second World War is the greatest self-inflicted catastrophe in human history. 60 million dead. That's 27,600 dead every day for 6 years. 1,150 dead an hour. If you were a German boy born between 1915 and 1924, the odds were 1 in 3 that by 1945, you'd be dead. 60 million dead in 6 years is a death every 3 seconds. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. That's World War II. George C. Marshall, the U.S. Army Chief of Staff, called it a great and terrible epoch. And new words would be required to describe it, words like genocide and superpower, which was a neologism coined in 1944. And old words assume new usages, words like Holocaust. The war ranged across 6 continents on those titanic 3-syllable battlefields that still serve as historical mileposts, Stalingrad, Tarawa, Anzio, Normandy, and in improbable settings rarely associated with the Second World War, places like the Aleutians, Madagascar, Syria, Darwin, Australia. W.G. Sebald was an elegant German writer who was born in Bavaria in 1944, and before he died in a car wreck in England in December 2001, he wrote, "We have appointments to keep in the past, in what has gone before, and is for the most part extinguished, and we must go there in search of places and people who have some connection with us from the far side of time." Well, toward that end, and taking advantage of our time machine here, I'd like us to keep another appointment in the past. On the morning of May 15, 1944, it's at St. Paul's School on Hammersmith Road in London. It's a Gothic building of red brick and terracotta. And on that morning, Winston Churchill, George Patton, Omar Bradley, Bernard Montgomery, King George VI, and several dozen of the most senior British and American commanders have gathered to talk about the plan known as Overlord for the invasion of Normandy. They met in an auditorium known as a model room, much smaller than this room. It's sitting on 9 hard rows of wooden benches normally reserved for schoolboys. John Milton, the English poet, among other luminaries, had gone to St. Paul's. Even in mid-May, it was as cold as a meat locker in the model room because German bombs had broken all 700 windows at St. Paul's School. On the floor of the cockpit of the model room was an enormous plaster of Paris relief map of the Normandy coast where the River Seine spills into the Atlantic Ocean, a scale of 6 inches to the mile. And as the plan was reviewed and as they talked about different things that they had planned, a British brigadier wearing no-skid socks shuffled around on this giant map with a pointer, pointing to places on what in 3 weeks would become the most famous battlefield in the world. Places like the beaches, Utah, Omaha, Gold, Juneau, Sword, and towns that most people had never heard of, but soon would be famous. Saint-Lô, Cherbourg, Caen, and over on the edge of the map, Paris. The man running that conference is someone you've heard of, Dwight David Eisenhower. In the spring of 1944, he's 53 years old. He's smoking 4 packs of Camels a day. His blood pressure is 176 over 110. That's stage 2 hypertensive. He's a 4-star general at the time of Normandy, but he's still in the ascent. He's rising, rocketing really, from lieutenant colonel to 5-star in 42 months. It's a promotion every 6 months. President Roosevelt has selected him to be the supreme commander of the Allied Expeditionary Force because he is, as the president says, a natural leader with exceptional political instincts. Eisenhower doesn't take this as a slur. He has a knack for getting along with the British, notwithstanding the extraordinary Anglophobia that infests the American military ranks. Unlike most of his U.S. Army peers, he likes the British. He's adopted words like petrol and tiffin. It drives Patton insane. He's also been chosen because he's got exceptional organizational skills. He describes himself as chairman of the board. That's the phrase he uses, chairman of the largest Marshall enterprise in the Western world. Well, the immediate task at hand, when they're meeting in the model room, is to project power in the most fundamental sense, to catapult an army across an ugly piece of water known as the English Channel. That alone is among the most complex efforts of warfare in the history of warfare. The channel is only 21 miles wide at its narrowest point, but armies over 1,000 years have found more grief than glory in trying to get across it. One British planner suggests that the only solution is to tow the beaches over already assaulted. And the Americans are thinking, well, if we go across the English Channel by sea, that's going to be hazardous because there'll be many Germans waiting for us on the beaches. If we come by air, by glider, or by parachute, that also will be hazardous. There'll be many Germans expecting that. What's an alternative? They commission a study to look at digging a tunnel under the English Channel. And the men who do the study come back and say, yes, sir, we can do that. It will take 6 months for 15,000 miners to excavate 55,000 tons of spoil. But we can do this. What they could never figure out was how to finesse the issue of having the entire German 7th Army waiting for the first miner to pop his head out of the hole. Well, similar, if somewhat less dramatic, power projection was going on elsewhere in the world. And of course, we had allies who were projecting power in a major way, especially in Eastern Europe. Now, this afternoon, I'm going to be focusing mostly on the United States, but when we talk about American dominance in World War II, we ought not suggest that the United States was the preeminent killing power. Soviet forces killed roughly 9 times more Germans than British and American forces combined. The Red Army suffered more deaths at Stalingrad alone than the U.S. military forces suffered in the entire war. Of a Soviet population of 190 million, 14% perished. Of an American population of 130 million, one-third of 1% died during the war. The United States had been among the last of the world powers, of the major powers, to be drawn into this fire. But very quickly, the war encumbered all of America. On September 1st, 1939, the day the war began with the German invasion of Poland, the U.S. Army, still at peace, comprised 190,000 soldiers. By one measure, it ranked 17th in the world in combat power and size, right behind that perennial military powerhouse, Romania. It would grow to 8.3 million by 1945. It's a 44-fold increase. 16,112,566 Americans served in uniform in World War II, again, out of a country of 130 million. Virtually every American had someone they loved in harm's way. Every American had an emotional investment in our military. Everyone had skin in the game. Fighting a world war required manpower, lots of manpower. By 1944, 11,000 young men were being drafted into the Army and Navy every day. It's a rate of 4 million a year. 1 in 3 GIs had only a grade school education. Only 1 in 4 had a high school diploma. 1 in 10 had a semester or more of college. A private, by the way, earned $50 a month. If he was awarded the Medal of Honor and survived the experience, he got an extra $2 a month in his paycheck. The typical soldier was 5 feet 8 inches tall. He weighed 144 pounds, but the Depression had been very hard on our nation's health. The desperate need for bodies in uniform, especially infantrymen, to go to places like Normandy, led to the drafting of what were known as physically imperfect men. I know women consider that phrase redundant. Standards had been lowered to accept defects which earlier would have kept a young man out of the military. So, for example, draftees at one time had to have at least 12 of their natural 32 teeth. How many teeth did you have to be drafted in 1944? Zero. And that's because the Army and the Navy drafted one-third of all the dentists in the country. And collectively, they extracted 15 million teeth, they filled 60 million more, and they made 2.5 million sets of dentures, all to enable those GIs to be able to masticate the Army ration. I know that sounds like an obscene act, but that was the standard. By 1944, a man could be drafted with 2400 vision if it was correctable to 2040 in one eye. The old line had come true that the Army didn't examine eyes, it just counted them. And in fact, you could be drafted if you were blind in one eye. You could be drafted if you were deaf in one ear, if you were missing both external ears. You could be drafted if you were missing a great toe or a thumb and 3 fingers on one hand, including your trigger finger. Venereal disease had kept many men out of uniform earlier in the war, but that restriction also was lifted, and the Army soon was drafting 12,000 men a month with VD, most of them syphilitic. How could they do that? Penicillin, that extraordinary discovery by British scientists in the 1920s. Was followed by a massive effort by the Americans and the British to take a substance that had been made by the gram, to make it by the kilogram, and eventually make it by the ton. Mental and personality standards for service in the armed forces also had been loosened. In April 1944, the War Department decreed that draftees need only have a reasonable chance of adjusting to military life. Psychiatric examiners at draft boards were advised to watch for 24 personality deviations, including silly laughter, sulkiness, resentfulness of discipline, and other traits that would seemingly disqualify every teenager in the United States. Well, why these extreme measures to fill the ranks? Because of the crying need for soldiers, especially infantrymen, especially riflemen. Even in a country of 130 million, we were running out. The Brits did run out. The war remained brutal and voracious to the very end. In April 1945, the last full month of the war in Europe, almost 11,000 American soldiers were killed in action in Germany. That's nearly as many as had died in June 1944, the month of invasion. It was awful to the last gunshot. The war cost U.S. taxpayers $296 billion. That's about $4 trillion in today's currency. To help underwrite a military budget that had increased 8,000%, Franklin Roosevelt increased the number of taxpayers in this country from 4 million to 42 million. In the European theater alone, the American prodigy of organization, that was Winston Churchill's phrase for it, would ship 18 million tons of war stuff to Britain and the continent. And that kit ranged from 800,000 military vehicles to footwear from sizes 2A to 22 EEE. By 1945, the United States had built two-thirds of all ships afloat worldwide. And the United States was making half of all manufactured goods worldwide. World War is a clash of systems. Which system can generate the combat power to prevail, whether it's in the form of 12,000 Allied aircraft overhead on June 6, 1944, the 10-to-1 advantage in artillery ammunition often enjoyed by the Allies during World War II, the mass production of penicillin and other devices needed to kill the enemy, the ability to design, build, deliver, and detonate an atomic bomb. Which system can produce and educate men, and they were mostly men, which is why the war took as long as it did, the men capable of organizing the shipping, the rail and truck transportation, the stupendous logistical demands of global war? It's often been said that in a fair fight, mano a mano, when one German battalion fought an American battalion, or a regiment fought a regiment, the Germans usually were better. A fair fight. Who's looking for a fair fight? Germany, despite an undeniable genius for tactical and operational warfare, could not muster the wherewithal to cross the English Channel, 21 miles wide, to invade Britain. The United States projected power across the Pacific, the Atlantic, into the Mediterranean, Southeast Asia, the seven seas, the infinite skies. Power projection, adaptability, versatility, ingenuity, preponderance, these are the salient characteristics of the U.S. military in World War II. Well, how 70 years and 3 days after the last shots do we assess the consequences? Well, first, of course, Allied victory strangled the sinister ambitions of Germany, Japan, and Italy. It also brought to an end the British and French empires. It politically fractured both a continent, Europe, and individual countries, Korea, Vietnam, Germany. It led to the creation of the United Nations and NATO, and it yielded a bipolar world, part Soviet, part American, that persisted for half a century. A war that was fundamentally about liberty spawned independence movements and colonial wars that led to the creation of modern India, Pakistan, Ghana, Kenya, Israel, and other states in a fermentation that is obviously continuing to this day. We Americans emerged from World War II with extraordinary advantages that ensured decades of prosperity, an intact, thriving industrial base, a population relatively unscarred by war, 2/3 of the world's gold supply, cheap energy, great optimism. As the major power in Europe, the Mediterranean, and the Pacific, possessing both atomic weapons and a navy and an air force of unparalleled strength, the United States was ready to exploit what the historian H.P. Wilmot once called the end of the period of European supremacy in the world that had existed for four centuries. The war largely dispelled American isolationism, even as it encouraged American exceptionalism, as well as a penchant for military solutions. And it also encouraged a self-regard that led some to call our epoch the American century. Remember what John Adams said? Power always thinks it has a great soul. Well, the war was a potent catalyst for change across the Republic. New technologies, jets, computers, ballistic missiles, penicillin, mass production of houses, soon spurred vibrant new industries, which in turn encouraged migration of blacks from south to north and all peoples to the emerging West. The GI Bill put millions of soldiers into college classrooms, spurring unprecedented social mobility. World War II was perhaps the greatest agent of social change in this country in the 20th century. Our national evolution on core issues of racial and gender equality are very much shaped by the war. Well, what did it cost besides $296 billion? Well, 13 U.S. divisions in Europe suffered at least 100% casualties. Five more suffered at least 200% casualties. From all theaters, American service casualties in the war included 1,700 left blind, 11,000 with at least partial paralysis of one or more limbs, and 18,000 amputations of U.S. servicemen. Aggregate numbers speak to how unspeakably inhuman the war was. Teasing out the deaths one at a time affirms our humanity. If you look at these big arrows on the map, contemplate the greatest self-inflicted catastrophe in human history, 60 million dead, it's proper to bear in mind the miraculous singularity of death. Each of those deaths was as unique as a fingerprint or a snowflake. Patricia O'Malley was a year old when her father, Major Richard James O'Malley, a battalion commander in the 12th Infantry Regiment, was killed by a sniper in Normandy. After seeing his headstone for the first time in that extraordinary cemetery above Omaha Beach, she wrote, "I cried for the joy of being there and the sadness of my father's death. I cried for all the times I needed a father and never had one. I cried for all the words I wanted to say and wanted to hear, but had not. I cried and cried. One, two, three." The Australian war correspondent, Osmer White, who bore witness both in the Pacific and with Patton's Third Army in Europe, later wrote, "The living have the cause of the dead in trust. We, the living, 322 million strong in America today, have the cause of the dead in trust. 70 years after that cause, let's keep the trust." Thanks so much for being here today. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you for that. So we've got time for questions or comments. If you'll come to the microphones on either side, and either aisle, we'll hear what you have to say. Yes, sir, go ahead.
Yes, thank you very much for an excellent presentation.
Thank you.
I've read quite a bit on World War II, and for some reason enjoy reading the part that deals with Europe more than the Pacific. And my question has to do with Operation Paperclip, which involved our bringing German scientists, especially Wernher von Braun, to the United States. And my question is, why was there not more of a reaction, or was there, especially on the part of the Jewish colony, Jewish residents of the United States or of Europe, for our treating them with such grace and pinning badges on them and giving them beautiful homes? Was, I guess, we were so worried about Russia getting a hold of them that we were willing to do anything.
Well, it's a good question, and it's an interesting part of the post-war. Wernher von Braun was a German rocket scientist. He had the brain for rocket science. He was also a devoted Nazi and a good SS officer. He later in life wrote a memoir called I Aim for the Moon. And the comedian Mort Saul said the subtitle should be, "But Sometimes I Hit London." You're absolutely right. There was a very extensive program to bring not only German brains, but German materiel to this country even before the war ended. It had been in the planning for a long time, and it was planned in part because there was an awareness that there was going to be a kind of gold rush for German brains and German material. Whenever the Soviets would overrun portions of Eastern Europe and then eventually Eastern Germany, they would strip it clean. It was like locusts came in. They would take everything. They would take the doorknobs, the light bulbs, the kitchen faucets. And we were very aware that they were also looking for people that could help them with programs that the Germans had become quite adept at, including jet airplanes. The Germans were flying jet fighter planes against us in the last 6 months of the war. So part of this scheme was to round up as many German scientists as possible, and particularly atomic scientists. We were interested in von Braun and others who had built the V1 and V2s that hit places like London, but we were especially interested in their atomic scientists. Why was there no outcry? Partly because it was kept quite secret. Partly because there was a very deliberate, quite effective propaganda campaign to suggest that, first of all, these guys weren't really Nazis, they were just scientists. And partly because within weeks of the end of the war in Europe, much less the end of the war in the Pacific, there was a recognition in this country that there was, in fact, going to be something that we came to call a Cold War, that we had a rivalry, and that the rivalry would exist between us and a Soviet bloc of some sort, and that having technological expertise, having materials of various sorts, and having allies in Europe, including Germans, was going to be important to winning that. So there were some people who protested, and as people realized eventually when historians dug into what von Braun and others had really done, there was an outcry, but it was minimal. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Sir.
Thank you for being here today. I had the good fortune while reading your three books, the trilogy, of reading them in light of Shelby Foote's trilogy in the Civil War. And I have kind of a twofold question. The first question is, did his trilogy affect your writing, the similar style, in writing your trilogy? And then one more of a maybe theoretical question. While reading them, I seem to sense a change in the application of just war theory, especially use in Bello, between the Civil War and World War II, especially when I was reading your trilogy. And I was wondering if that shift is something that you recognize, if it's there, or am I mistaken in it?
I don't know that you're mistaken. I don't know that I'm smart enough to discern whether, in fact, I was doing that deliberately or not. First, on the issue of Shelby Foote, many of you know Shelby Foote was a novelist. He'd been a captain in the artillery in World War II. He's a Southerner. And he put aside fiction and took up the cause of writing history, narrative history, and wrote a masterful three-volume history of the Civil War called The Civil War. Yeah, he's influenced me for sure. I would go back and read, there's 80 pages on Gettysburg, and I would go back and read that just for the lyricism of it. Now, I must say, Shelby Foote wrote 3,000 pages without a single footnote. It's the keep him guessing form of annotation. And you can't really get away with that, I think, today. It doesn't lessen the lyricism of what he wrote, and it doesn't lessen my enthusiasm for him, but the degree to which he influenced me stopped there. I recognize that attending to all the requirements of appropriate acknowledgments and proper endnoting is critical, particularly for a non-academic. And your second question, I don't know that I've got an answer to that. I haven't thought about it. Sounds like a good dissertation for somebody to write. Thanks.
You've given us three great books of World War II in North Africa and Europe. When will you give us another great book or books on World War II in the Pacific?
Oh, fie. I use that word deliberately because I'm now working on the American Revolution. It's an 18th century pronouncements come to me naturally. I decided some time before I finished, quite a while before I finished Volume 3, that I was going to leave World War II. 15 years had been long enough working on the trilogy, and the natural pivot would have been to go to the Pacific. It would have required me to start the war over again, for one thing, and I didn't want to do that. And I'm more, my head swivels to Europe. I was born in Germany. I lived in Berlin. I'm just naturally more interested in that portion of the war. I am interested in origins. Where did we come from? Where did that army, that 8.3 million man army come from? Well, it comes from, obviously, the American Revolution. And so I've been working for more than 2 years now. I'm doing a trilogy on the American Revolution, not because I think trilogies are the cat's meow when it comes to narrative structures, but because that's the way the story breaks. And I'm a little more than 2 years into the research for the first volume, which will end with the Battle of Princeton in January 1777. And I don't miss the 20th century at all. When will it be out? You sound like a publisher. probably I've got another year of research and then a couple of years to put it together, so several years. Thanks for the question. Yes, sir.
My question is a little bit like his. I thought you were going to do a book on D-Day. Is that not true?
On D-Day?
Yeah.
Well, the third volume of the trilogy is, the first quarter of that book is about Normandy. I don't think I could be more exhaustive without exhausting the reader. The publisher has taken that third volume and pulled out part of it and done a kid's book called D-Day for junior high kids.
That might have been what
I read. So, yeah, but no, I'm not going back to June 6, 1944. No, thanks.
And thank you very much for enlightening my education on words that I've never seen in 59 years. It's unbelievable.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you for the presentation. On a somewhat personal level, if you found yourself in 1941 as a 21-year-old, knowing what you do, I'm wondering what you think you might have done in 1941.
Well, I think I would have done what my father did. My father was born in 1924. He just turned 91. He's a career infantry officer. When he graduated from high school in whenever that was, 1943, he enlisted in the Army. And I think even with perfect knowledge at the time, if I somehow knew how awful the war would be, I would also know what the stakes were, and I would know what it had given our country, what it had given the world. And so I'd like to think that I would have done what so many did, to step up and do their duty. Now, I don't want to sugarcoat it. There were more than 23,000 deserters from the American Army in World War II. The notion that all the brothers were valiant and all the sisters were virtuous is complete nonsense. It's not human nature. At one time, it seemed like all 23,000 of those deserters was in Paris, working in the black market there. So there were lots of people, but it's a relatively small percentage, who didn't want to do it, who didn't want to go, sometimes for reasons of conscience, which we permit in this country, sometimes for reasons of cowardice. And there were some who got there and didn't want to serve. It's interesting that only one execution for desertion occurred in World War II. It was a troubled young man from Michigan who had deserted almost as soon as he got to Europe. And Eisenhower was looking to make an example of somebody. His name was Eddie Slovic. And Private Slovic was taken to the Vosges Mountains in eastern France. And Eisenhower specifically decreed that he would be put to death, executed by firing squad, by his comrades. And they did it. They shot him dead. But he was the only one executed. There were plenty who went to prison, and there were others who were sentenced to death, but those were never carried out. So It's easy for me to say in 2015 that I would have done right by my family and my country, but I like to think I would have done right. Hi.
Excuse me. So I'm wondering what exactly happened to the Nazi generals after the war. Like, Hitler committed suicide, for example, and many of the officials were sentenced to death. But what about the ones that didn't get sentenced to death? What happened to them?
Well, that's a really good question. Well, what should happen to him? What do you think should happen to him? Well, there were, first of all, there were hundreds of German generals who were killed during the war. They had a very high rate of attrition. They were killed either in enemy action, they committed suicide, they were killed in accidents, a lot of them killed in plane crashes. As the war was turning our way and we began capturing German generals, beginning in North Africa, by the end of the war, we'd captured hundreds and hundreds of them, we and the British, the Canadians, the French, and others. For the most part, they were sent to prison. And depending on their degree of culpability or the extent to which we could discern their culpability, the degree to which they were guilty, if they were big generals who had participated in war crimes, they tended to go to prison for years. So I'll give you an example. Albert Kesselring was the commander for the Germans in North Africa at first and then in Italy, very, very capable field marshal. He was captured, he was convicted of war crimes in connection with the execution of Italians, more than 300 in the Ardeatine caves near Rome. He was sentenced to death. That sentence was commuted. He went to prison for about 10 years. He wrote his memoirs in the best tradition of felons. And the other thing that was happening with all these guys in prison, incidentally, a lot of them were taken to Fort Hunt. If you're from around here, you know in Alexandria, there's Fort Hunt Park. Well, there was a secret debriefing center there, and our intelligence officers were interviewing a lot of these guys even before the war ended. The interviews continued in earnest right after the war ended, and the first question that was asked all of them was how to fight the Russians. Because many of them had been fighting the Russians on the Eastern Front and then were transferred to the Western Front, and we were particularly interested in understanding Russian tactics, how best to fight Russian armor tactics and so on. So most of them were subsequently let out of prison, serving typically anywhere from 2 years to 10 years. And many of them reintegrated into the German society, and some of them went into the Bundeswehr, the German military that was created after the war. It was a recognition that Germany needed an army, partly because of the Russians, and some of those officers were permitted to become Bundeswehr officers. Thanks for the great question. Sir.
Yes, sir.
This is the last question, I'm told.
Son of a World War II veteran, son-in-law of another. We who live here are fortunate to live near Civil War battlefields. Where would you recommend people who are interested in understanding World War II to go, two or three places?
Well, I'd start with the cemeteries. You can start with the cemetery that's right across the river in Arlington. There are plenty of World War II veterans buried there, but those American Battle Monuments Commission cemeteries, there's more than a dozen of them that are overseas. The most famous of them is the one that I alluded to earlier on the bluffs above Normandy. But there are others that are exquisite. There's one in Carthage, outside of Tunis. They're beautifully kept by the locals. In North Africa, the flora and the fauna is spectacular, and thousands of graves perfectly arranged. There's one also in Nettuno at Anzio. Same thing, absolutely spectacularly heartbreaking place. If you're going to look at battlefields to have some sense of it, Normandy is tough to beat. It's an extraordinary place. The French remember what we did for them, what sacrifices were made there. I was there last year with Brokaw, in fact, on the 70th anniversary of Normandy. The Italian battlefields are really interesting. And so if you go to Rome and point south, Anzio is a fascinating place. And farther south, Salerno, where the American and British landing force was almost thrown back into the sea. It's fascinating, but you need to take a good guide or a good book with you because there's not a lot of signage, unlike our battlefields here. Thank you again so much. Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.